Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to Matter. My name is Stephen Collins. I'm the CEO here. For those of you who aren't familiar with Matter, we're a healthcare technology incubator and innovation hub. We opened almost exactly 2 years ago. Today we work with about and used by the healthcare industry. One of the things that we do is we try to bring in interesting people and interesting companies, interesting products and technologies, and feature them, kind of understand what's going on in healthcare, everything from cutting edge technologies in research labs all the way through to interesting developments in policy, of which we have maybe too many these days. So our speaker tonight fits squarely in the interesting category. So I've been hearing, I've actually just met Mary for the first time 5 minutes ago, but I've been hearing her name for years, regularly and repeatedly, as somebody that we need to get to know. She's actually been to Matter previously, and we'll be back later this week, and we're really happy that she's here. The reason why I've been told, I'm not going to read her entire bio, but I am going to point out a few things because it's impressive. So she leads an organization called Mary Furlong and Associates, and has been working on issues related to longevity and aging for more than 30 years. She's a professor at Santa Clara University Levy School of Business. She's founded a couple of companies and organizations before she founded her current venture. So she started a nonprofit organization called SeniorNet in the mid-80s and an organization called Third Age Media in the mid-90s, and between those raised about $130 million worth of venture capital, donations, and different sponsorships. She's been named in a whole bunch of different publications. Fortune Small Business named her one of their top 25 women entrepreneurs. Time recognized her as one of their Digital 50. She was named one of the 100 most influential women in Silicon Valley. She served as a White House commissioner in the Clinton administration on libraries and information science, which she just informed me that organization, like many others, is on the chopping block. She's written a couple of books, one called Turning Silver into Gold and one called Grownup's Guide to Computing. Her name comes up again all the time. Every time I mention aging or we're doing something in aging at Matter, they say, well, you need to talk to Mary Furlong. I'm excited to welcome you here. Thanks for being here, and we're looking forward to hearing your blueprint for longevity. Please welcome Mary Furlong.
Thank you very much. It's really fun to be back here. I'm a startup kind of girl, so I was here when there was dust on the floor, and literally, you were just moving in, and we publish a conference called What's Next, and they said, if you want to see what's next, you have to go to Matter. So we brought about 40 people to Matter, and it was really exciting to see the growth and the progress. So I'm working on a new book called The Blueprint to the Longevity Market. Usually people call me a visionary, and I don't really like that very much because visionaries have visions, but they don't necessarily get things done. So through the years to build a company is, how many of you are entrepreneurs? Yeah. As you know, to build something, you need a set of plans, you have your vision, you need your funding, you need your team. So what I hope to talk a little bit about is the blueprint of what it takes to build a business in this economy. So as you just heard, I started this when I was young. So When I was 30, I wrote a book called Computers for Kids Over 60. And of course, everyone thought I was so young and attractive, and now I'm 68. So I've been at this for my whole career, and largely because when I wrote this book, which was a very selfish thing to do because I just wanted to publish. I was at a university, and they said if you publish, you could get tenure. So to write the book, a colleague came up to me who was quite a good technologist and said, you know, everyone's talking about computers in schools in California. They want to put a computer in every classroom. And why don't we write a book called Computers for Kids Over 60? So we bought Commodore 64 computers and 300 baud modems and a flip chart and lemonade and cookies. And we went around to senior centers and nursing homes all over the District of Columbia, Maryland, and Virginia. And people would say to us, I can't see it, I can't hear, but I love what you're doing. And I thought, if you can't see and you can't hear, how do you even know what we're doing, you know? But what they felt was, why shouldn't they be empowered to be part of the computer revolution? And in one dawning moment, I decided to dedicate my career to older people and to the empowerment of older people. Now, like me, many boomers are now growing older, and so there's a lot more time and attention to this market. But my joy about being with an older person has never left me, and my sense of them being empowered and being part of the computer revolution is really important. And in fact, when I asked one of the SeniorNet members if he could plug in the Macintosh, he said, I used to be the chief scientist at Rockwell. I think I can plug in the Macintosh. So at SeniorNet, we had over 100 centers around the country, and we watched how older adults used the computer. But it turned out that the magic in this was the network. And if we could connect them to their children or their grandchildren, they would be so excited, even though the children might be sending a message, or the grandchildren, I'm off to college, dear grandpa, send money. And so there, that was kind of the elementary telecommunications. Now, this was before AOL, so it was Delphi and the source, and then AOL, which probably some of you think you're really old if you use AOL, right? But those were the early stages. But there was this tremendous power to social networks. And for older people who, around the holidays, we think the staff may want to take out for the holidays. Well, people that live alone, they get lonely during the holidays. So it was our peak time of people to connect. And many of those people were caregivers. Many of those people were connecting online because they may have had something physically wrong with them and they were more homebound. So we built the first social network for seniors. This was before the movie, The Social Network. See, things have come along that made the story easier to understand because now you know what a social network was. So this is sort of the early days. And after the person who helped me, I'll show you his picture in a minute, create SeniorNet was the co-founder of Sesame Street. So how many of you know Sesame Street? Okay. So 90 countries, and over a dinner party, and I like to share this story with entrepreneurs, because over a dinner party in New York, Joan Cooney told Lloyd Morissette that she had an idea for children in television, that it could be used to really make a difference in children's lives. And Lloyd said, at the time he was vice president of the Carnegie Corporation, he said, why don't we make that vision come alive? So as an entrepreneur, don't ever skip a time in an elevator to share your vision. Never let a dinner party not be a chance to share that idea. I get pitched a lot, as does Jody. I try not to be pitched in the gym, you know, but you should view anyone as your potential audience. You really never know who's going to embrace that idea. So Lloyd wanted to have someone take a look at telecommunications and older adults the same way that he had they looked at children and television. So he went around to universities and he asked people in the universities, including Stanford, any of you interested in older adults? No one said a word. And finally, someone said, you should go talk to Mary, because she's kind of interested in that. And so we found each other, and he not only was a great mentor, but he helped shape the vision of SeniorNet. Now, 10 years into this, he decided to retire. And SeniorNet became embraced not only by by the Markle Foundation, but also by IBM, and also by the Bell companies, because they wanted to show the power of telecommunication and older adults. Just like today, Samsung and IBM and others are trying to get, are getting involved in this new revolution. So I went to raise money, but most foundations don't like to give money to a startup that's 10 years old. So, and it turned out, I thought that e-commerce was going to be the next great wave, and that SeniorNet commerce online. I still think this is true today. I talked to an entrepreneur today who called me and told me his company has gone from $100,000 in revenue to $10 million in revenue, and one product in the last 3 years. And so I do believe there's a lot of products that can be created and can scale in going to this audience. So anyway, we ended up creating a for-profit company that was called Third Age. It was part of the CBS Keiretsu. So they had Sportsline, Marketplace, and we were kind of the lifestyle play. And we became the first baby boomer portal. We sold it in 2002 to Ancestry.com. It was a nice exit for us. And everyone went on to do something else. In fact, we just had the anniversary of Third Age in September. We're having the anniversary of SeniorNet next summer. Some of the people will be 90 years old that are coming, and they're still teaching and working in those centers. So I say to you, if you're a visionary, you should be your visionary, start one company, maybe start several companies. One of my friends at USF said to me, you build companies the way other people bake cakes. And I am really always enchanted by the next idea. So I got a job offer at Santa Clara University, and a friend of mine said, you can't give up your work. You have too big of a Rolodex. So you should do something with it. So I started a newsletter, and then I started a conference. And I was lucky because we have two colleagues here from AARP. From the very beginning, AARP started to support the work, and our conferences grew. In fact, we're having a conference here on Thursday in Chicago called What's Next. And it really is the blueprint to the longevity market. So I want to just talk about the objectives that I'm going to cover, sharing your business vision. So Joan Cooney was a visionary. Melinda Gates is a visionary. You can have a vision that has a sense of social purpose. And in fact, many of the companies that are formed in this marketplace become B Corp companies because they also give back in some way. And most entrepreneurs that are in this space, they have some kind of personal story as to why they got involved in this market. We're going to talk about the growth segments of opportunity. We're going to talk about the business ecosystem, how to raise money, sales, my biggest success, my biggest mistakes. Since this is live stream, we may not have time for all of that. And then some resources. And I want to open it up to questions. So this is me when I was young, when we were starting SeniorNet. I like to show that picture. This is Lloyd Morissette, the co-founder of Sesame Street. And he came to our company, which was on 2nd and Howard in San Francisco. And he gave a talk. And one of the things that at first our company was bridged. And so I had to ask the investors for money. In fact, I had to go show them what we did each week. And then we would get an allowance for the next week. And so we were always driven to succeed. And one day, the tech person, Joe, said, we really need a couch so we can have meetings on Friday. This was before pool tables were part of the agenda. We actually had Bill Bradley as an investor, so we put in a basketball court in our office. But that time on the couch for some of our employees, we bought the couch, and on Friday at 4:30, for some people, that was their only communal meal. And so we would say, what did we achieve this week? What did we have to do to get better? Ann Wendlandt from Hummer Wendlandt says, when you're an entrepreneur, you have to be a cheerleader and a waitress. Every week we take orders from our customers, and every week we rally up the team. This was the launch of Windows 95. And when I went up to this launch, that's when I went back and I said, the internet's going to be bigger than I thought. I'm not going to keep SeniorNet alive with funding from another nonprofit. I better build a company, talk the investors into providing support for my original nonprofit, which is an art of conversation, I have to tell you, because investors don't really want to hear you have a nonprofit from the very beginning, but these were the right kind of investors, and so that was when we started the second company, Third Age. Jody is here. Do you want to say this yourself? No, okay. This is Jody, and I didn't know he was coming, and I am so excited that he's in my slideshow, but I really do, I love this quote, because I think this slide is even more important this week than ever before, because how many of you think you're going to be funding your retirement through your pension and Social Security? Notice in nobody, you do. Okay. What did you do before? I mean, do you have a good retirement? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, TIA Cref was a good place to be. Now, when we were young, we had like five, this for the women in the audience, we had five opportunities. You could be a librarian, a nurse, a social worker, a teacher, and maybe two became real estate agents. But if you were really cute and spoke multiple languages, you could be a Pan Am flight attendant. And most of us wanted to be Pan Am flight attendants. In fact, I really wanted to be a Pan Am flight attendant. And my father said, no, that's like a waitress on a plane. Well, some of my friends were, and they ended up losing their pension. So part of the reason we have this uptick in Encore entrepreneurs is because we had a few blows along the way. So if we think that Washington is going to enhance our meals on wheels so that they're organic, we can give up that dream because we have to fight for that, and we have to fight for PBS, and we have to fight for other things. In fact, I think in my next season, I have to be both an entrepreneur and an advocate. And so, but I truly thought Jody captured this when he said, in Washington, addressing the needs of 100 million people is called an unaffordable cost. And it's not just in Washington, it's all around the world where people talk about, they whisper when they say copay. You know, I was in Spain, that was the only word that everyone had a scared look on their face about was copay. In Silicon Valley, for entrepreneurs and increasingly for investors, the needs of 100 million people are called a business opportunity. And now, in the next section, I'm going to show you where these opportunities are. Now, you're in the right place, because there's no bigger opportunity than in healthcare. And there's a lot of riches in the niches. This is a friend of ours, Steve Jurvetson, quite a well-known venture capitalist in Silicon Valley, and truly one of the nicest people you could meet. He said that demographics is destiny, and there are three trends that build value. Demographics. So 77 million boomers. Top of the boomers are 71. What happens in 7 years? I'm very interested in 78-year-old women. If you just run into a 78-year-old woman, learn everything that she says to say. If your mother's a 78-year-old woman, take her to lunch and all her friends, and then ask them what's on their mind. Because as Ken Dykewald says, if you want to catch an elephant, you dig a big hole to where they're going. Where the world is going is 77 million people are going to go from 71 to 78. And that's why you want to build a business that they will use. Whether that's skincare, it's healthcare, it's travel. So demographics is really important. Technology is really important. And so we've never had more deal flow from around the world, from Singapore to Israel, to Chicago, to New York, to Silicon Valley, where people are looking at the aging of the world, and they're using the best technologists to come into this market. So when I look at who's coming to the conference on Thursday, I can see some of the, there's an entrepreneur coming from Israel. His company has already had their product put into the London School of Design, and they haven't even launched yet. It's called Intuition Robotics. So there's this great convergence of technology, talent, discovering the longevity market. And then lastly, there's the regulatory environment. So no one knows more than the people here what happens if your product is now suddenly covered by Medicare. What does that do to your business? And so we have to be so on point in understanding the regulatory changes and those opportunities. Now this is my favorite slide. We're actually giving an award to the person who created the slide later in the week, Greg O'Neill. And in the slide, you see the US population growth by age. I think you should all have this hanging in your office. I think you should give it to everyone you meet. And so in 2010 to 2020, what happens to the 66 to 84-year-old market? It's growing by how much? Up front, you could see. Patrick. Okay, you see the 66 to 74-year-old market. And what happens to the market of people that are 16 to 34? It's minus 1.9%. And so then you go over here and you look 2020 to 2030, what happens to the older market? It's growing. And this is the case in Korea, Japan. You can have access to the slides. But Jody and I always like it when people take pictures of our slides. We think it's really quite flattering, you know. Now, this is a new chart that we've just designed. Going back to that for a second, when my student entrepreneurs want to design something like an app for them to do laundry with, I try to educate them about this opportunity. You know, I try to say to them, I know that your latest app for these services. My favorite quote last year was Kara Swisher from Recode said that San Francisco's assisted living for millennials. You know, I know millennials that haven't been to the grocery store in 4 years. They live on a street, and their laundry goes out, their food comes in. It's fascinating to watch. And I have a friend, Josie, who recently had a stroke. Now, she's 75. She could use every single one of these services. But for her to have the technology on the phone and the knowledge about accessing the services. So one of the most exciting developments is where the on-demand economy meets the longevity market. And it's exciting because it's not only services that they need, but it's also jobs they can have. And so, you know, I take Uber sometimes to the university so I can read a lesson plan. It always unnerves me when my Uber driver's my age and a woman who's 67. And I think, you're going to drive me to the university because I'm having trouble driving myself there. But it's really, really interesting to see the job creation opportunities and this marketplace. So I'm going to stop. Any questions so far? Okay, then anybody? Okay, we're going to keep going then. So I'm thrilled about this new slide. We've been spending 3 months taking a deep dive into this topic, and we've been asked by a research group to really size the longevity market. And so we looked at it. He said, well, there's nonprofits in this market. There's people like ARP, which reaches 37 million people, right, this week. The size of Poland. And they're not going away, because who among us is going to cancel our discounts or our membership and pay the copay if we don't have supplement insurance? And also, who else is advocating for us on the Hill? So there's nonprofits, then National Council on Aging, Gerontological Society on Aging, this summer in San Francisco. They're having a conference, first time in 33 years, the Global Conference on Aging in San Francisco. So 8,000 people are coming to that. There's associations, and then there's the federal government. So it turns out the federal government spends the most money on this population. But as entrepreneurs, we never really think too much about how can we engage the federal government and which part of the federal government, and who in the federal government is really making decisions that we need to pay attention to. And then there's investors. And I think the internet today, the internet in 1995 is where the longevity market is today. The internet in 1995 is where the longevity market is today. So people are coming out of universities, just like Katie Fike did out of USC, and saying, I think this market's really attractive, and I don't want a career on Wall Street. I want to build a business in the longevity market. That's kind of the gifted class early adopters. So just as people were thinking, what should I do? Why not go after this market? And the venture capital community, some of them, like Jay, the CEO of Breezy, are coming in and building companies in the market themselves. So, yes. So we're beginning to see angels, and we're beginning to see venture, the venture capital groups in Silicon Valley, like DCM Ventures and others. And we also are beginning to see new funds form, like the Ziegler, who's based here in Chicago, Linked Age Venture Fund, and ARP has a fund. And also, we're beginning to see corporations say that they are going to take some of their money, senior housing groups, in-home care groups, and put that into strategic investing. Why not get upside in the things that they're building? So you can see, watch for companies like Home Instead, CDW, and others who are really helpfully getting to the market with technology and services also begin to think about a potential investment arm. Even consumer product goods companies, and we recently met a beverage company that's now designing beverages like cranberry juice with immunity and other kinds of sweet potatoes and carrots and other kinds of nutritional products that are good for you as you get older. It's not just skincare, although we spend a lot on skincare. Because when you're dating again, and one in three are dating again, if you're young, you just put your hair in a ponytail. Like, Amanda, you can go out tonight with your hair in a ponytail. For a boomer, it takes us a day a week to get ready, you know. It doesn't take us a day a week. It takes the guys a day a week, too. They have to buy foundation. Okay, and then there's, I'm glad you got the joke. And then there's the entrepreneurs. And they are the most zealous and the most exciting. So in terms of my book, which is older, but we're rewriting it, it's a global market. I did my book and found out it had been translated into Chinese, Dutch, and Korean before I even knew that. So more books have sold globally than have sold in the US. And it is the longevity market. And I give Jody credit for taking that concept and describing how it is a political economy. And he has our keynote on Thursday, and so he's going to show. Yes. Yes. I'm not an expert on this, although one of our experts is Mark Miller, is here in Chicago, and he writes a lot about this. It's really two-tiered. So you've got some people who were teachers or professors, doctors, and had pensions, government workers. Then you had a lot of people whose 401k became a 201k, whose parent had a lingering illness and they had to pay $8,000 for a nursing home, whose caregiving journey lasted 17 years. So you may be taking care of your adult parents longer than your children. It's usually a shock to people. Imagine, like, 18 years on this journey. So it's a club sandwich generation, so that no one feels flush. So even people who have a lot of money are worried that they aren't going to be able to finance to the end. Because the good news is, we're 68. We might live to be 102. So how are we going to finance ourselves through those years? And I love that Prudential campaign that says you spent more time on your likes today than on your retirement planning. And so the second part of that, I'm extremely worried about half of the boomers who have very little money. And that's why we're seeing this uptick in jobs, encore careers, on-demand marketplaces, and new kinds of savings plans, and also new innovations like Silver Nest, where people will rent a room to a senior. And so the real cost of care, it's one thing to get sick and you're at the Park Hyatt and they bring you a concierge doctor. That's a really nice way to get sick. I recommend it to anyone. And they come within a half an hour, take care of you, and it's a really good way to have an office visit. For most people, the funding of their retirement is not easy. So they're dealing blackjack. They're waitresses. They're working in retail. They're downsizing. And if they have a child with special needs, as one in six do, or they have a grandchild, I'm going to talk about the grandparent economy, that's even more difficult. So I think there's a lot of neglected business opportunity around the lower income part of the country as they get older. Discretionary spend, I can always answer in more detail in an email afterward, but it's clear that I think, you know, there are people in this country who really have to choose between pet food, their own food, and their medication. And it's a much larger number than we know. So for them, the dollar store is a great place to go. And you'll see a lot of brands that people are quite excited about. You know, like those shows you see on television where you can win a prize if you're part of a lottery. And then there's kind of a lot of people in the middle who are helping their grandchildren with babysitting because the two parents are both working to buy a house. And so we've gone from kind of voluntary caregiving to voluntary babysitting, helping out there. And then there's the few that are on a cruise. And that's really small, I think. Now, in the cruise industry, they would say it's a big niche. But there's one example. There was a company called Elder Hostel, which had the most trusted brand for seniors. It was seniors traveling, staying in hostels. The boomers were more demanding. They wanted to stay in hotels. But the boomers could only travel for 4 or 5 days, so the trips got shorter. And the boomers are also traveling for caregiving. So this myth that we're off on a cruise, I think, is really a myth. I think it may be four of your girlfriends together to have cosmetic surgery in Seattle in a slumber party, or, you know, which people actually do. The Sorrento is where they stay in Seattle. But part of what I wanted to say is that I don't think that their discretionary, I'm going to show you where some of their discretionary money goes. And so life stage transitions, you go through more transitions in your 50s than any other time in your life. You usually have two parents when you're 40. Oftentimes that means you have one parent when you're 50. And so therefore you're now a caregiver. Now being a caregiver, you don't have 9 months to become a caregiver, you have 9 hours. So, and if your family lives far away, that means you get a phone call and it says, And it's happened to me. I got a phone call. I was on my way to give a speech at Jenny Lake. I'd never been to Jenny Lake. And my father had a heart attack that morning. And my mother had a sympathy heart attack that night. Lucky she lived. But the shock of losing him, because they danced to Frank Sinatra in the kitchen every day. So it was just too much for them, for her. Now, she recovered. But most people, when this happens, you don't get a lot of advance notice. And that becomes a new role you play. So in your 50s, there's these caregiving changes. There's retirement. You know, you might have to touch up your hair so you don't look like that old guy at the office. You know, you have to stay relevant. You can't bring a yellow pad into a meeting anymore. You have to learn how to get along with millennials. There's a lot of things that happen in the workforce that plays a role. And so many people phase out of full-time work, and that's a change. One in three are divorcing. And so if they change that brand, they're changing other brands. The children are there. Then the children are gone. Then the children are back. Then the children are redoing something else. They've decided to become a blogger and build a brand themselves. I don't know if you've seen that TV show with John Goodman, but I love that show about Washington, where he talks about his daughter who started her own TV show. So the children are going to have 11 careers, according to John Zuckby. The culture gap between you who made your bones in the corporate world till they gave you a pin, a pension, and retirement is a myth. And so we have to be there when our children hit these walls and then have to redefine where they are, because the economy is happening, doing that to them. Whether that most of the companies in Silicon Valley hire 40% of their people are often contractors. And so they might have a job, but it doesn't necessarily come with benefits. That's why that 26-year-old age limit to provide health care to them. So this is a long way of saying they don't feel flush. They feel pressured. And it's hitting at them from all sides. And the biggest pressure to them is the health challenge of their own. So God forbid they have a stroke or something else. Technology can play a key role. And then the most important part, I think, is spirituality. Because at the end of the day, you're going to exit the freeway. And you don't want to think, what did I do with my life? You want to think about, what is the real meaning? And so that's important. Now, I was so excited. I took pictures in the lobby because I'm about to be a mother-in-law. I'm so excited. It's a little bit of a year away, but I have the most wonderful daughter-in-law. So, of course, I walk in here, and what do I see? It's the bridal fair in Chicago. And so we have a look at what the bride's market is. We have a look at the new mom's market. Anybody who's a mom? Well, you know, the babies, they don't just come with a few things. Sometimes it involves a car purchase, a stroller, and other things. But this is the caregiving market. And so the caregiving market is one of the biggest markets. And Lori Orloff, who's the top analyst on the caregiving market, is going to be here on Thursday, and she's going to talk about this caregiver ratio. In some cities, there's a very small caregiver ratio to the number of seniors. I just pulled up the data on Florida. You all should have a branch office for your business in Florida, because it is a huge market. Margie, you know a little bit about Florida. Do you see any seniors down there? On occasion, okay. And, okay, Lori Bitter is my co-producer of our conference. She couldn't be here tonight, but she's written a book on the grandparent economy. And I think what's really interesting in this niche is how large the grandparent economy is. Because people think that the next group they want to spoil are the grandchildren. But it's not just clothing. It's education. It's savings account. It's paying off student loan debt. It's rent. Oh, good, another slide, another picture, I'll tell Lori. And then there's travel. I was talking to somebody today who was telling me one of AARP's greatest membership benefits is the travel bag, and that a lot of people love that. So there's both this adventure travel, there's service travel, and there's, I think we could cross Syria off the list. for now. This was an older slide. Although I have a driver in San Francisco, and he's from Syria, and he keeps wanting to take me to the Middle East. It's on my bucket list. I don't think there's anything more magical than traveling with their grandchildren or service-related travel. And so who among us doesn't want to go to the Red Cross or help out in some way? These are some of the brands. The Apple Watch, I forgot mine, but my sister every morning tells me how many steps she walks. There's Great Call. There's Carelinks, who will be here. So Sherwin Check had to leave his job at a hedge fund manager in New York because his mother had to take care of his sister who had MS. And he watched how hard that was. So he created a platform for you to be able to find a caregiver, much like you find an Uber driver. Judy, I'm going to borrow your voice to say something about posit science here first, so I can have some water.
Discovered adult brain plasticity. And with Jeff Zimmern, founded Posit Science, and it's a company that has brain games, of which there are many companies, but it's the only company that has well over 120 peer-reviewed studies that actually shows the efficacy of what they did. And for those who are football fans, and I lived in Chicago for 9 years, so I'm an old Bears fan, but Tom Brady uses Posit Science's regimen and tools in addition to all the other silly things he does.
And in fact, Jeff's going to be here on Thursday to talk about how Tom Brady won the Super Bowl using in part the software. Yes. And quite a comeback. So there's a lot of riches in this market. There's riches in the niches. And you have to think about what the biggest niches are. One of the biggest niches is diabetes. That's the convergence of diabetes and obesity. So if you can speak Mandarin, and you know about diabetes, and you can come up with some solutions, this is really an important thing. I just saw this company with diabetic socks get funded last week. So now, that's sort of, any questions on the riches and niches part? You know, I give this around the country because we run a business plan competition, just like the live pitch, similar to that Jody does, and which is coming up in April. But I was at Harvard one day, and a student said to me, okay, Mary, of all these niches, which one should I build my career around? Is it housing? Is it senior housing? Is it healthcare? Is it grandparenting? And the answer, much like Shark Tank, which I like to watch, it depends on what you build and what big problem you're about to solve and how fast you can get there. And that depends on your team. So this next section is about business lessons. We'll take about 5 to 10 minutes on it. But any questions about the niches? Or have you all found a niche? Yes, what's your niche? Tell us your name and your niche.
We're engaging with technology. And then earlier you talked about how important it was to use technology to sort of access a network, whether it's their grandchildren, that sort of thing. Do you think a lot of older adults are leveraging technology to sort of solve for loneliness, or
is that? You know, I think thank you for that question. One of the things I've always wanted to create was a widow support network, because, you know, we're gonna have someone gone one day, and who's gonna cure that issue? Is one of the biggest issues there is. I think social networks can be powerful ways of bringing people together, especially things with patients like me and other things like that. But currently, I think that the network's under-leveraged, and we have to build more partnerships of people who are actually working with the customer and working with the technology. So some of the work that Ziegler's doing, where they, through the Ziegler Linkage Fund, where they're funding companies, and they're also doing pilots within that investor, within the investors in their network. Or at ARP, where Jody actually brings the members of ARP together with the entrepreneurs who are creating the technology. In fact, the People's Choice Award, CareLinks won, and now is in a pilot with you. So act like a business owner. This is from a book called A Boss's Life. I highly recommend it. You could tell I'm a faculty member. I'm giving you homework already. I'm going to give you my favorite books. You're only in business, really, 6 months, 2 quarters. So every Monday morning, I sit down with my spreadsheet, and I look at my pipeline for the week. And every Friday, I talk to a colleague, and I say, how did you do with your pipeline? And we expect 10 sales a week, each of us, of some kind. So we know that it's going to take 10 sales calls to get that done. And if a company's creating strategy, they can only really do it for 2 quarters in this space, because there's always a new player coming to the table. And then you can look 6 months out. One of my investors, Alan Rothenberg, said to me, put this sign above the door of your startup and look at it every day. Revenue keeps the doors open. So I see so many, the biggest mistake I think entrepreneurs make is they fall in love with their idea. They love the product. They don't think about the distribution. So I think it's really important to identify the channels of distribution into the market. That's in-home care. It's nonprofit. Posit Science is now in every library in America. So who are the potential? And a company bought Posit Science for every library in America. So who are your potential partners, and where is your business growing? Oh, this is just some of my favorite pictures. Because when you're the CEO, you get to have great adventures. So this is Katie Couric. We were on the Today Show. And I always say, get your hair done if you're on the Today Show. That's an affordable business expense. Wear good shoes, because you'll get a lot of emails about your shoes. And really represent your company in 3 minutes. So you should be able to tell your elevator pitch in 3 minutes on CNBC. This is what some of our team. We would always do great team building and bonding. We used to interview potential CEOs on a sailboat. If they didn't have good problem-solving navigation skills, we just didn't give them the job. Securing investment. One of the most coveted possessions is your angel investors. And so we're actually bringing some angels here on Wednesday to Matter. We'll have quite a few angels at the conference. And it's rare if you have an angel investor. Most people don't like to share their angels. And some angels don't want to be known that they're angels. And so they're often, we see in the longevity market, it's the first round of funding is coming from people that they know. Could be friends and family, could be someone that they made money in business before. And then there are strategic investors, which are senior housing, home care, financial services. We're beginning to see the financial services industry find out about this market, pay attention to things like caregiving. And we recently did some workshop for First Republic Bank a couple years ago, where we did book clubs on caregiving in First Republic offices. The venture world, and I give, I guess, Jody a lot of credit here, because he's been really helping people see and educate that community about the market. And there's some reports that they have published that really provide great data. And then there's the nonprofit partners. And the nonprofit partners really have the trust of the consumer. So I think Diane's here in the audience. Diane, yes. And tell us what you do.
nonprofit membership organization that links older adults to each other and to trusted resources.
So a perfect partner for you to test out your idea with. And also share equity with them. So we're doing a workshop tomorrow morning at ASA on how nonprofits can build their revenue base by partnering with entrepreneurial organizations. These are some of our business plan competitions. Every year we do a business plan. Our most successful company was in the pet space, pet insurance. They are now a $100 million company. Discovered them about 14 years ago. They have a magazine called Fetch. They're an AARP partner for health insurance. Venka is now moving into Matter. Is Venka here? Really great company that helps with technology to solve problems around end of life. PureCath is a partner that has improved treatment for kidney dialysis so that there's no infection when you're getting your treatment. And the co-founder of that company, I mean, the founder of that company also co-founded Health Tech Women, which are 11,000 women in health technology. So again, this is another look at the business ecosystem. I would start with distribution. You know, Don Jones, who used to be at Qualcomm, said to me, Mary, you should own distribution for the boomer market. I didn't quite understand what he meant, but I thought it sounded good. So since then, I've been searching for distribution. Well, distribution is at villages. And distribution is with health insurance companies. And distribution is with churches and faith-based organizations. And distribution is with large corporations that own senior housing and in-home care. And so even countries like Spain, which would be a great place to go, I was in San Salvador, they used to have one kind of economy, and they decided to migrate into the longevity marketplace. So they were looking for the next growth market. I think it's important to meet the bloggers, the analysts. There's something like 2,000 healthcare bloggers. There's a lot of people that cover the age beat. You've got to know where you want to go in terms of public policy. Walgreens here. Our two stops on our learning journey this year are Walgreens to understand their new strategy as large footprint into retail space. The Higgy Station. I get my blood pressure taken at the Higgy Station, and they record that, and that's how I know I'm tracking weight and blood pressure. And Higgy's here based in Chicago, a really exciting company. So they are in Rite Aid. So you have to pay attention to where the customer goes. And they're digital. They're increasingly using things like e-commerce. So we're about to launch a new marketplace this summer where we're going to feature some of these really exciting products. We used to represent a cane company that was in lollipop colors. And people tell me how much they love these canes. We also have a company that makes a bag for your walker. I'm very interested in candy apple red walkers. So by the time boomers get there, we're going to really take a look at what are some of the products and services that we want. So if you were a motorcycle rider when you were young, you're going to have that kind of motorcycle when you get older. So we don't give up who we were. We have, if anything, we have more passion around who we are. We have more passion for the things that matter the most. And we're going to spend money on that. The biggest successes, building brands, making a market, recruiting teams, improving the lives of older people, that's really what this is all about. If you can make a difference in someone's life because you've provided them with chefs for seniors and you have someone who comes in and makes meals for them once a week, or you've provided a working mom with a solution with a caregiver in 5 minutes that she needs so she can keep her job. And making a vision become real. I also love curating events. I love an audience. In fact, now that we're all friends, you all can have my password, which is FOM, friend of Mary. and you get 20% off our conference on Thursday. And our conference is like an orchestra of talent. It is like going to the art museum, because what you see is a field of flowers of people that are building companies and making a difference in the lives of other people, only they're doing it with this entrepreneurial spirit. So you don't, you just kind of guide them, have places where they can do speed dealing and networking at lunch. And I also think we have to step up to the role of thought leader. We actually have to have thoughts that matter. And we have to think about this great responsibility of who is going to lead this next generation of seniors if not us. Who is the Claude Pepper in the house that cares about them? And how can we become advocates for their needs? My biggest mistake, I think it's always hard to get your business model right. I've had the best investors, I've seen some of the worst, and the best is always better. So it's all about who's around the table. And I would say if you have one decision to make, get the people on your board and around the table to be the strongest that you can find. And the next is a team. You have to have the very best team. And I often tell entrepreneurs, if you ask yourself three times you have the wrong person on your team, you've answered the question. And the biggest mistake they tell me is they stayed too long with the wrong person. So you have to kind of be recruiting and upgrading your team all the time. My husband said, I like upgrades, you know? Who doesn't like upgrades? So when I had a cold and I knew I had to speak all week, he said, why don't you upgrade to first? And I said, oh, why not? You know, it was a great flight yesterday because there was a little bit of an upgrade. So think about that with your team. Who can you have as your reverse mentor that's the smartest person you can find? So we have someone working with us. I said, okay, how old are you? She's 23. Perfect. She'll know how to do all the social media, Instagram, Pinterest, and everything. And then I think another mistake is not thinking big enough about the opportunity and the partners, because it's bigger than you think. So if you're a media company, does that mean Bertelsmann? If you're going to market, what is your China strategy? If you could have investment on a global level, who would you want around your business? So in Toronto, there's a lot of deal flow now in the longevity market, and some of those groups actually have foundations that are also doing social investment. And then I think you've got to get your process great. Margie Drumhiller's with us. I don't know of anybody who's better at process than Margie. I've worked with her for a long time. And you've got to have someone who can see ahead and know all the places that things get done, or more importantly, where things could go wrong. So your team has to have great operations, great technology, great salespeople, and great HR people. And you have to build a culture where people want to stay. You know, in the race for talent, talent wins. So if you're not having people cemented into your business every day, they're indeed looking out where else they can go. So the biggest entrepreneurial insight I would have is hire the smart people, keep them close, build them, and then send them out to do great things. So that's what I would say. I like to sort of end on a more inspirational note. The title of my book is Turning Silver into Gold. The silver is the money we can make in this market. There's a lot of money to be made. The gold is the good work we could do. And if we can make a difference in just a few older people's lives, that could amplify a lot. And that is the most worthwhile thing you can do as an entrepreneur. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Gosh, you should see me when I have a voice. Thank you very much. The slides will be available. Any questions? Comments? Or? Tell us your name.
My name is Zach, and I work full-time during the day, and then at night I volunteer with an organization in Atlanta, Georgia, that is teaching technology to seniors. I became their volunteer marketing strategist. And one of the niches we're going after is where we've used this as a tool to be lead development into the senior living community, and they in turn fund the mission to teach seniors technology in that area. One of the areas that we're dealing with in terms of marketing is that we've noticed that we've had to go, instead of using social media and all that stuff, we've had to go to direct mail. I was wondering what your experience is with that and print media and television, and are we going the right direction with that?
And we have a great panel talk about YouTube. A lot of things are now launching with YouTube content. I love radio. I like radio and print. I like a strong internet presence. And I hate to see people spend a lot of money on direct mail, but if you could get your messaging right and you can get your target right, I worry about this a lot because the Neptune Society keeps writing me. And you know, in print, you know, and I'm not ready, you know. And so I think you want to refine those messages in your other forms of media and look at local newspapers. I love church bulletins. You can advertise in a church bulletin for $10. And suburban radio or rural radio is another great place to go. And don't forget about co-marketing. One of the best things we ever did with J&J, they co-marketed with us, so we created a sleep center for them, and they put us on every Tylenol PM bottle. So give up something to let the villages market with you about what you do. Oh, another thing on senior housing. I was talking to Katie Roper at caring.com, and she was saying that a lot of people search by zip code. They search locally. So if you're opening up a new senior housing group, they're going to go look for that. And a lot of times people will go look under the disease state and then find you another way. So they'll type in Parkinson's. But if you're solving a problem for caregiving, you've got to solve it in your own geography. I feel like we should say a sentence about Live Pitch. Could you tell them about that in 2 weeks?
So Innovation at 50 Plus Live Pitch is a competition and a conference. It's happening at the Computer History Museum April 12th and 13th. This is the sixth year that we're doing it. We've had over 1,000 companies over the 6 years apply. We only put 10 on stage each year, although this year we've added a vertical. So of our first 50 finalists, so it's a unique conference in that on one level it's the traditional demo day, right? We have the VC judges, everybody does their pitch, they get interrogated by the VCs, everybody feels terrible until they see they won. And but we do something different because when we thought of this, we figured the world didn't need another demo day unless it was different. And what does AARP have that nobody else has? The consumer. So we bring in AARP members. So last year, for example, at an event of 400 people, 200 were AARP members. So we have a judges winner and a consumer choice winner. And so we give everybody wireless voting devices. And so after the judges have, are finished with the entrepreneurs, then we take a sounding of the room on three questions. Is what you're seeing unique? Does it address a significant need? And would you use it and or refer it to family and friends? And it's pretty fascinating. And so you have this dynamic triangular value exchange where the entrepreneurs are getting real-time market feedback. The VCs who voted earlier are making assumptions about what the market will and won't like, and now they're hearing from the market to confirm or turn their assumptions on their heads. And for our members, we're giving them an opportunity to weigh in on innovation that is ostensibly being designed for people like them. So I encourage you to come, cop a flight to Silicon Valley. Mary's promised that it won't rain. And April 12th, 13th at the Computer History Museum.
There's 40% of all wealth creation comes out of Silicon Valley. So, yeah, that's great. And I think, I really think this connection between what's going on in these incubators. So one of the other rises has been the rise of entrepreneurship. And so the networking from your incubator to others. And then in July 20th, we have the Global Conference and the Silicon Valley Boomer Venture Summit. We give a $10,000 prize for the best idea. So thank you. Thanks, guys. Okay.